After a week of mathematical distraction, I know you're probably having withdrawal symptoms from quantum computation, and I have just the antidote. Today, we study the details of quantum oracles, those unitary and therefore reversible transformations that simulate the classical Boolean functions, which are the actual targets of our algorithms. I can't show you how to build an oracle from an arbitrary function. That's a craft that requires knowledge of the specific function. There are lots of papers out there that address the construction of oracles for specific Boolean functions on a onesie-twosie basis. What I will do is show you how we construct the matrix of the oracle for any f. While we're at it, we'll extend what we've already studied, single-valued functions, to the more general vector-valued functions, that is, those that have multiple Boolean outputs. Finally, this is the right place to introduce the difference between relativized versus absolute quantum speedup over classical computing. It's a distinction that we must always keep in mind when designing our algorithms. So we start off by analyzing the small one-in, one-out functions f, of which there are only four. Not only do we get to cover every one in depth, but the techniques we employ help us build oracles for more complicated functions. One of those four functions is the identity, f of x equals x. From the truth table for the oracle, we easily produce its matrix. As you can see, it's unitary, which, by the way, we suspected. After all, an oracle is always its own inverse, but it's nice to confirm here. By stepping back a bit, we can actually resolve U sub f as being composed of two smaller 2x2 submatrices, the identity and sigma x, the Pauli spin matrix for the observable Sx. This is more than just a casual observation, as you're about to learn. We'll repeat this with a slightly larger function, still single-valued, but one that has a wider input or data channel. The process is the same. Build a truth table and construct the matrix. Nevertheless, we go very slowly and carefully through the steps because there are so many combinations it would be easy to get lost otherwise. Our diligence pays off, though, because at the end, we find that this necessarily larger matrix is still composed of only two moving parts, the 2x2 identities and the Pauli spin matrices, sigma x. When we finally look at a vector-valued function, the smallest possible, one with two outputs, we see the pattern repeat with slight variations. The matrix consists of small, separable operators whose 2x2 components are just identities or sigma x. Such observations confirm, by the way, that U sub f is unitary, as required by the quantum circuitry. We wrap up with the topic of relativized versus absolute growth improvement. When we build a quantum circuit and its accompanying algorithm, we'll be counting both the number of gates needed and the steps used to get the answer. That'll account for the computational complexity, right? Wrong. Until we incorporate the complexity of the oracle, through which every qubit must travel, all those other computations merely provide a lower bound for the big O. It could get worse if that oracle has a more costly growth rate. So how do we accommodate this inconvenient truth? With vocabulary. If we don't know the oracle's computational complexity, but we do know that our circuit around that oracle has a better growth rate than the classical algorithm, also measured around, but not including, the function f, then we say we have a relativized speedup. You see, the oracle will have the same time complexity as the function, and a classical algorithm will use the function at its core. So we compare our solution minus the oracle with a classical solution minus the function. If it's faster, we have relativized speedup. On the other hand, if we happen to know the complexity of the function and its oracle, then we do have complete knowledge of the whole enchilada. Our big O is going to be accurate for that particular function. In that case, we can make hard claims about the growth rates. And when we get speed up, it's called absolute speed up over the classical. With Simon's algorithm, we'll only get relativized speed up because we won't know the functions. And some periodic functions happen to have exponential growth. The same will be true of Shor's period finding algorithm. However, for Shor's factoring algorithm, we will know enough about the function to claim that it has polynomial growth. I'll demonstrate that in 2 weeks. So, when we design our polynomial fast algorithm around the oracle and compare it to the exponentially slow classical solution around the function, we'll have absolute speed up.